Okay, so now we start with autocorrelation, detection of autocorrelation. This is part two. So you have seen this slide in the previous session also. We said that there are two ways. One is graphical examination, the other is formal test. In the previous slide, you've already covered Durbin-Watson B test. In this session, we are going to talk about the remaining two tests, that is Durbin's Edge test and Roche-Godfrey test. So let's start with Roche-Godfrey test. Now, what are the features of Roche-Godfrey test? Now, it is a more general test for autocorrelation as compared to Durbin-Watson B test. Why is it a more general test? Because it allows for non-stochastic regressors as well. So for example, if there is YT minus 1 as an explanatory variable in the regression, Durbin-Watson B test could not be used. But now, Roche-Godfrey test can be used. And second reason is that it's not just AR1 scheme. We can even use Roche-Godfrey test for autoregressive schemes of higher order, maybe AR2, AR3, etc. Right? So notice that Durbin-Watson B test was not applicable in the above two cases. That is why we call it as a more general test. Now, what are the steps to conduct Roche-Godfrey test? One, run the original regression. So for example, you have all these regressors. Now, one of the regressors can be YT minus 1 also. That's allowed here. Okay, I say that again. One of the regressors can be YT minus 1 also. That dependent variable is allowed. So we run the original regression. We obtain OLS residuals ET. And then we regress residuals ET on ET minus 1 and all explanatory variables. So this is the regression, auxiliary regression that we are supposed to run now. So all your original regressors are there. T2, X2, 2XK. And we also include ET minus 1. Now notice the coefficient that we have written here is rho, right? Rho. If the sample size is large, then Roche and Godfrey have shown that n times r square of this regression of equation 2, it follows a chi-square statistic with 1 degrees of freedom, right? That is, nr square follows chi-square k. Now, k is what? K is the number of lags in the residual term. In this case, because we are assuming it's AR1, therefore, K is equal to 1 in this case. Now, what is N? Be very careful. N means number of observations which are there in equation 2. Now, if you compare equation 1 and 2, suppose there were 50 observations in equation 1. Okay, 50 observations. So, when you run the regression, you get the residuals and then you also need ET minus 1 for this. So you cannot have 50 observations here because you will lose the first observation. You are taking one lag term. So now if there were 50 observations in equation 1, there have to be one less observation, 49 observations in equation 2. That is why we are writing here, number of observations in equation 2 will be number of observations in equation 1 minus 1 because you are losing the first observation. So our decision rule is going to be as usual, if our computed value, that is nr square, is greater than the critical value at the chosen level of significance, then we will reject null hypothesis. That is, in that case, we have the evidence of autocorrelation. That is, rho is going to be statistically different from 0. Now let's try a question based on Roche-Godfrey. So this is the question. So in the regression model Y on X2 and X3, you are given the auxiliary regression results. You are given R square and you are given N. So what basically we want is, we don't even want the output of this auxiliary regression because what we want for our purposes is just N times R square. Right, so the solution is going to be as follows. First, step one, we write a null and alternate hypothesis. Null hypothesis is no autocorrelation. Alternate hypothesis is presence of autocorrelation. NR square, we know, follows chi square 1. So let's compute the test statistic. This is 34 multiplied by R square of this regression, that is 0.567, 19.278. We go to the tables, chi-square tables, and pick up the critical value at 5% level of significance with degrees of freedom 1. That turns out to be 6.64. And what is our decision going to be? Because our computed chi-square, that is 19.278, is greater than the critical value, we reject null hypothesis. We are rejecting null hypothesis. That means there is evidence of autocorrelation. Right? So this is the kind of question that you get, you know, regarding the testing of autocorrelation using Grish-Godfrey test. Remember, what we need is n number of observations in this regression, and we need r square of this regression. Suppose we were given n equal to 34 for this, for the original regression. In that case, n for the auxiliary regression would have been 34 minus 1, that is 33. I say that again. In this case, n is given for the auxiliary regression itself. Suppose n was not given for this regression, but it was given for the original regression, then which nr square, which n would you have taken here? Then it would have been 34 for the original regression minus 1, that is 33. I hope that's clear enough. Now next, let's start with Durbin's H test. So H test can be used only in large samples. That is first thing that you must remember. So you have the original model as YT on XT. Notice here, lagged value of Y is allowed. So if this model was given, can we use Durbin-Watson D test to find out, to check for autocorrelation? The answer is no. We cannot use Durbin-Watson D test. However, we can use Durbin's H test. Okay. So what are the steps? Run the original regression. You will get the results. You will get the regression coefficients. You will get the standard errors also. Now use estimated rho and compute H statistic. Now how do we estimate rho? Rho can be estimated by using the relationship between D and rho. Okay. So using this formula, you find out the value of rho and then use it for H statistic, which is given by this formula. Rho hat square root n upon 1 minus n s square dy minus 1. Now n means, of course, number of observations. What is this part now, s square dy minus 1? This is the estimated variance of the coefficient of lagged dependent variable. So when you run your original regression, the standard error that you get here, you square it, and that is going to be the variance of the estimated lagged dependent variable, right? So you square it and you get s squared dy. So the null hypothesis is going to be rho equal to 0, that is no autocorrelation, and HA is going to be rho not equal to 0, that is there is an evidence of autocorrelation. So under the hypothesis of no autocorrelation, it has been found by Durbin that H is distributed as a normal variable with mean 0 and variance 1. Because it is a normal variable, therefore, which table do we refer for critical values? We refer to Z table for critical values. Now, H statistic may pose certain problem. Now think about this. this is a square root. This is a square root, right? So if your denominator turns out to be less than zero, that means if this part n times s square is greater than one, then you would get a negative component here. In that case, it's not possible to compute h, okay? And if denominator is approximately zero, so if it is almost equal to one, n times s square is almost equal to one, then it is going to be approximately equal to zero, and hence h is going to approach infinity. So these are specific cases where h may not be suitable, or it may not be, you know, valid enough to be computed. So let's try a question based on h statistic now. So a researcher estimates following demand function for money for 100 countries. 100 countries. N is 100 here actually. So no, it should not be 100 countries. It's 100 quarters. 100 quarters. N is 100 here. Now, log of MT, these are the results that you are given. R square given, Durbin-Watson t statistic given. And what you have to do is you have to use Durbin's H statistic to check if there is an evidence of autocorrelation. So how do we write the solution? H naught is rho equal to zero, that is no autocorrelation. HA is rho not equal to zero, that is evidence of autocorrelation. Now notice here that when we use Bruch-Gottfried or we use Durbin's H, we don't talk about positive or negative autocorrelation. Positive and negative autocorrelation hypotheses are valid only in the Durbin-Watson D test, because in D we know about the range. Here it's either zero or not equal to zero. All right. Now rho hat we computed from the Durbin-Watson D statistic, which is given to us. Okay. And H. Sorry, this should be 1.32. This should be 1.32. So using this rho hat, we then compute the value of H statistic. So N is 40 here. Okay, variance of the lag term is going to be square of this term 0.03. It should be 0.03. So we get the H statistic. Critical value is 1.96. And what we get is that conclusion, because computed value of H exceeds critical value, therefore we reject H naught. That is, we get an evidence of autocorrelation. There are some mistakes in the question. I'll just correct them when I release the final PPT with you, right? So the solution, I'll change the numbers in the question so that it matches with the solution. Okay, so can we continue the question further? So given the similar results as previous question, can we use Durbin-Watson B statistic and can we use Bruch-Gottfried test? So I take you back to the previous slide. Now, because there is a lag y term sitting here, lag dependent variable term sitting here, therefore Durbin-Watson B statistic cannot be used, but yes, Bruch-Gottfried test can be used, right? So what we are saying is that if you have lag dependent variable as explanatory variable, then which test can be used? Two tests. Either you can use Durbin's H or you can use Bruch-Gottfried. Okay. Yeah, so this is what is mentioned here. Durbin-Watson D cannot be used because there's a lag dependent term as one of the explanatory variables. And the answer to the question, can we use Bruch-Gottfried test? The answer is yes. Now, a last point in this chapter, in this session rather, this always remember, whenever we find evidence of autocorrelation, it could be due to two things. Either it could be just pure autocorrelation, or it could be result of misspecification of the model. That is, whenever you find autocorrelation in the regression results, then always, always think about it could be due to model misspecification. That is, we may have committed specification error. So if you take up applied econometrics in next semester, then we'll be talking much more on this issue. Right now, keep this in mind. Evidence of autocorrelation could hint specification error as well. So thank you for the time being. We'll start with remedial measures in the next session. Take care till then.